Dr. K. Trivenkatswamy, Professor and Head, Department of Harbour and Ocean Engineering of AMAT University. Now, I am going to give a special lecture on coastal structures, its importance and design methodologies. As you all know, the port is one of the important trade hub, or I would say it is a business hub for any country. See, in India, we have so many major ports as well as minor ports. So, the port operations plays a major role in India's economy improvement. So, if we want to have an efficient port operations, the infrastructure should be good enough for import and export of the logistics. So, port situation prior independence, this lecture covers the port independence, how it was prior independence and how the government sponsored port development is there, then privatization of port in 1991, then challenges posed by port policies, the challenge of the future portlet development. So, my lecture will cover all these aspects. See, in early 20th century, there were only 4 ports, the Calcutta, Bombay, Chennai and Karachi. Calcutta was a riverine port and largest ships of that day were able to enter the Hooghly. The port of Mumbai was sheltered by islands, so reclaimed to provide a shelter bay. The first challenge was the Madras port, hitherto an open roadstead with major losses of cargo in and literage. See, you can see the top view of the port, or I would say it is a bird's eye view. See, this is a top view which shows the various port components. See, these two are the main major breakwaters. This here also the breakwaters, and this you can have the navigation channel here and all other port accessories, diaphragm boards, loading platforms, all will come into this. So, this gives a general definition, or I would say it is a pictorial sketch for a port. So, here you can see another port top view, where you can see the how it is a river estuary, and alongside you can have the port. So, this shows the complicated nature of the coastal process and how it interacts with the shoreline. So, in such situation one has to design a port, it is a design challenge. So, if you go to the next one, see this shows Paradip port, this is a Paradip port bus stand. So, you can see there it is a river based port, and it comes into the channel through the navigation channel, the ships can enter this and it can be berthed along this side. So, these are the typical structures of a port operations. So, this type of port operations depends upon the port location and the coastal geomorphology. The design of the coastal structures will be entirely different considering the wave climate. This shows the Mangalore port, which you can see it is a converging breakwaters. Here you can see the two breakwaters converging, and it is a open sea. So, the vessels will enter here and it will go into these berthing locations. So, here you can see one on the left, two on the left sides and one on the right side. So, this is also a typical port layout. So, if when you see the different configurations of the port layout, one can come to a conclusion that design of these structures, it is really a challenge. Why it is a challenge? The main challenge is due to the random nature of the waves. Waves are challenging aspects. It hits the coast with high impact. So, the impact force exerts a lot of pressure on the coastal structures. So, especially during the monsoon and the heavy storm surge situations, one can see the heavy overtopping. So, when you want to design a structure, coastal structures, you have to design against the wave overtopping and the heavy impact. So, for that there are so many several methods that we will see in the coming sessions. So, you can see how the port development, So in 1981, there was a financial crisis. Consecutively, government of India liberalizes the economy. So the entry of private sector in port development happened in the 1990s. So the captive facilities developed at Bhadwara for Ambuja Cements, at Hazira and for SR Steel, at Hazira and Reliance Industries, and at Dahej for Indo-Gulf Fertilizers and Chemicals. Joint sector ports at Mundra and Pipavav. So these are the major port development after 1991. Why we have 1991? You know pretty well that the 1991 is an year of a crisis. So how this port development happened of that, one must know. So the new port policies, how it has been evolved. Maharashtra 1995 and Gujarat 1996 announced new port policies. New port policy enunciated a principle of not encouraging captive facilities. All new licenses to be multi-user, multi-cargo. Earlier captive licenses encouraged to become multi-cargo. Gujarat Maritime Board commissioned feasibility or DPR, detailed project report studies for 10 new ports. So, as I said earlier, how if you want to develop the implement the port policies, obviously you have to develop the infrastructure. So, who will develop the infrastructure? We, the coastal engineer has to develop. Coastal engineers, coastal modelers have the, they must have a sufficient knowledge. How to do? See, if you see the challenge to port engineers, one, it may be recalled that the challenge to port engineers was earlier based on an understanding of physical processes. As you all know, the wave mechanics from wave reflection, wave transformation, wave propagation and all. With the effective implementation of the CRS Act by 1995, the port engineer had to deal not only with the physical processes, but also deal with the environmental impact. The port engineer had therefore to develop an overall knowledge of the environmental impact and more important to design remedial measures. So, privatization brought even more challenges. Having made this investment in bidding for the greenfield port, the entrepreneur needed a bankable project report in double quick time. The traffic had to be assessed very carefully to decide the phasing. A master plan had to be kept in mind without affecting the bottom line. So, you can see this image. See how the port operations happening here. You can see the big loading crane. This is a moving cargo equipment for coal transfer, and these are the jetties and the transferring mechanisms. So here you can see the how the calm basin is being formed. How this calm basin is formed? Only through the construction of breakwaters. So the breakwaters, we the coastal engineers have to assess the wave loads. Then only you can design a breakwater. See this pictorial sketch, you can see the loading and unloading of a cargo from the ship. So you can see a ship is berthed and these are the fenders. Fenders, you can see the loading, how it is to be loaded. This is not a ship, this is a sea wall which has a fender, and you can see the bridge structure on which the loading platform is there. So, loading and unloading will happen in this region. So, here you can see the a pictorial line sketch of a Gopalpur port which has several groins. So, these are the groins which happened, this serves as a shore structure for the protection of shore and as well as for protection of the near adjoining coastal areas. So, if you see the groins, what are groins? Groins are short crested low mounted breakwaters. They are nothing but breakwaters with a low height. So, the groin serves as a structure which are usually it is being constructed perpendicular to the coast and sometimes it is parallel, and this gives a lot of protection to the shore, thereby reducing the sea erosion. So, that is groins. So, here you can see the erosion and accretion at Gopalpur port. So, from the year, as the year passes, the erosion rate steadily it is increasing. So, the eroded shoreline, you can see how eroded. So, this is another point where we have to concentrate the protection of coast against the erosion. So, how to protect? The only way is to construct breakwaters or a sea walls or a groins or bulkheads also, sometimes bulkheads needed to design the structure. So, here you can see the Hazira private port. Here you can see the very wide basin, that is the harbor basin with two breakwaters. So, you can see the straight line breakwaters. So design of a straight line breakwater is much more complicated than a shoreline with breakwater with some inclination. The straight line breakwater will have a direct impact with waves. Okay. So now if you want to have a development in port sector, so there are two important challenges. What are those challenges? The port is no longer a response to the needs of the hinterland, but an active stimulus for the development of the hinterland along lines that are most suitable to its geographic location. The port engineer is now expected to look into the future and merge plans of the port development to the needs of the identified development of hinterland, which should be concurrent. So this gives the eye opening. What are the new challenges which we have to take in the design of port structures? See, the port engineer is therefore to be an expert in various branches of engineering and at the same time protect the environment, understand finance and hinterland development planning. So now we are entering into the technical part of the lecture. So the design of breakwaters. So breakwaters, as I said earlier, breakwaters are structures which are either perpendicular or even sometimes parallel to the coast. So if you see the definition sketch, see, this is a land. So you can see this like a bay. So the ocean is sea is there. So you can have the breakwater. If you want to have this, can you observe this? So this shows a lagoon type or like a closed bay, gulf. So we can, this is a suitable location to develop a port. So these two are the breakwater structures. So that the calm water basin is developed, formed in order to have a smooth berthing of vessels. So this will, vehicles can enter. So how to design the various components of a breakwater? Before going further, first you should be knowing about the force on a body. So you can see this is a horizontal surface. So you have a body. So this is a force acting on this, external force. So you can see this is a W, bottom W, weight. And when it is placed in a water, when it is placed in a water, so this is a upward force, buoyancy force. Upward force is buoyancy force, and this is a downward force. And due to the force, you will have a opposite side is a resistive force, F resistance, with some mu is the coefficient of friction. So this is a very, very basic principle before going to a design of the structure. When you go to the design of a component of a structure, each component is influenced by the wave force. So the wave force is the external force, So let us assume that this is a body, say a concrete cube or even a structure or a rubble. It can be an either rubble mound structure or a caisson breakwater, concrete caisson breakwater. So this is a horizontal force and this is a weight, W weight. This is an uplift force. Uplift force is nothing but due to force due to buoyancy, Fu. Force due to buoyancy. Force due to buoyancy, and due to that, by the basic physical phenomena, there will be a resistive force. Fr is nothing but mu into Fu. What is mu? Can anyone say? So mu is the coefficient of friction. So this is a very basic phenomena before going to further design aspects. You can see, again I repeat once again, Fw is the external force, usually for our case it is the wave force. W is the weight of the bottom, weight of the structure. So usually this W is nothing but m into g, mass into acceleration due to gravity. And mu is the coefficient of friction, mu. This is the coefficient of friction. Coefficient of friction, Fr is the resistive force, Fr is nothing but mu into Fw. So this is a very basic, I would say it's a free body diagram on a coastal structure. So from this, what are the various possibilities of a failure of a structure? When a structure will fail? There are two conditions, there are two possibilities for a body to fail in the ocean environment. That is, one is due to the sliding, failure due to sliding, and another is failure due to overturning. So, sliding, there are two conditions of failure. So, sliding and overturning. So, when we talk about sliding, please listen, you have a flat surface, a body is there, So, when an external force is applied, so the body will tend to slide. So, this is a sliding distance. So, the sliding distance, the intensity of sliding and the sliding distance, it depends upon the two factors. One is W, another is opposite resistance, mu into Fw. The third one is uplift Fu, force due to buoyancy. So, the sliding failure happens when Fw is less than, Fw is more than the resistive force. So, this is one of the sliding, this is the failure due to sliding. The another another failure is due to the overturning. When your body will overturn, now let us see the overturning phenomena. So, the overturning, please listen. Fw, that is force due to wave, this it can act at any point. So, let us assume that this is a water level and this is mu into Fw. Okay. Now, on the toe, based on this point, it will try to overturn. So, how it will overturn? So, it will overturn like this. So, this is moment due to wave. So, how to safeguard this? What is the various possibility to safeguard this overturning? See, when you design a coastal structure, any structure is impacted by the enormous wave force. So, due to that wave force, there are only two possibilities. One is sliding failure, another is overturning failure. Failure due to sliding, failure due to overturning. So, these two are mainly for the gravity structures. You know what is gravity structure? Gravity structures are structures that are standing by their own weight. Gravity structures are nothing but the structures that are standing on their own weight, its own weight. So, the failure will be, one is the sliding, another is the overturning. So, sliding due to the horizontal movement, overturning tilting of the structure based on this point. So, how to neglect, how to avoid this, or how to safeguard the structure? So, designing the structure against the sliding and overturning, how to do? So, the geometry of the structure should be arrived in such a way that it has the safety factor more than one. So, when we have the safety factor more than one, the stability of the structure is ensured. So, how to do that? Before going further, first we should have an overview of the various methods to assess the wave forces. So, we have about three well known methods. to calculate the wave forces. One is Godard's wave force formula, another is St. Flour's wave force formula, another is Minikin formula. In this, the Godard's wave force formula is very much suitable for the breaking waves, which occurs frequently in the nearshore region. So, Godard's formula, Minikin formula and St. Flour formula. Now, let us see one by one. So, now, what is the Godard's formula? What are the modalities in the Godard's formula? When we see that modalities in the Godard's formula, assessment of wave forces. How do you assess? As I said earlier, we have three formula. One is Godard's formula, another is St. Flour formula, the third one is Minikin's formula. Minikin's formula. So, Godard's formula, Godard is one of the well known professor from Japan, Yasumi Godard, 1973 established the formula to find the wave forces here on a concrete structure. So, if you see the Godard's formula, say for example, please listen. So, this is a concrete structure, it is a still water level. Godard formula assumes a triangular force variation here, bottom baseline, then this is a Godard's pressure diagram. So, this is a P2, this is P3. So, this is called HC, this is a height of the structure above the still water level. So, this is shows the pressure distribution. This shows the pressure distribution. This shows the pressure distribution diagram. So, P1, P2, P3 are the pressure components. And this is the width of the B and this is the uplift forces. So, let us assume that this is HC, this is overall height small h. So, this is your D, Now, before going to the other formula, now let us see how the force is being calculated using the pressure diagram. So, P1, P2, P3 are the important force components. P1, P2, P3 are the important force components which occurs at, one is at a still water level, another is at a ground, another is at the base. So, if you know the P1, P2, P3 are the functions of the wave height, wave force, water depth, wave period, everything. So, once if you establish P1, P2, P3, now let me explain how to calculate the total wave force. So, please listen. See, I redraw this diagram, pressure diagram. So, this is your pressure diagram, Godard's pressure diagram. Okay, so please listen. So this total height is, total height you take it as h. So this is your HC. So this is your water depth D. So, this is P2, P1, P3. Okay. So, now let us calculate how to calculate the force. Force is nothing but the area of the diagram. So, for example, pressure P, pressure will be in Newton per meter square. H will be in meter. So, D will be in meter. So, if you calculate the area of the diagram, for example, P 1 into H, you will get a Newton per meter. So, this shows this much force per unit width of the wall, per unit width of the structure. So, now let us calculate the area of the diagram. Okay? So, in order to calculate the area of the diagram, you are dividing this into a comfortable areas. So, you are dividing this trapezoidal into one rectangle 1, one triangle 2. Similarly, this trapezium is divided into 4. Now, you can see one rectangle, one triangle, another rectangle, another triangle. Now, it will be easy to compute the area of the diagram. When you calculate the area of the diagram, that is equal to the force. So, how to calculate the area of the diagram? In order to calculate, first we must get the dimensions of the each one, each diagram. So, A1 area of the diagram equal to, I would say, P2 into HC, P2 width into total height. So, that is A1. A2 is triangle. So, half B. What is B? How do you calculate B? B is, I would say, P1 minus P2. Can you able to understand? Base is P1. Please listen, you have to be very careful in calculating the area. So, here the total width is B1. Total width is B1, the height is HC. So, how to calculate this base of the diagram, base of the triangle? Total width minus P2. So, P1 minus P2 into HC. Next, A3. A3 is another rectangle. So, here the height is D. What is the width of the rectangle? You have to listen very carefully. Here total P1, you have to consider this width, that is P3, not the P2. So, when you consider this triangle, the base of the triangle is P1 minus P2. For this triangle, P1 minus P3. So, for this base, so half into P1 minus P3 into total, this height is D. So, A1, A2, A3. So, these are the, another is A4, this is A4, this is A4, A3 is P3 into D. So, A1 is the area of the rectangle, A2 is area of the triangle, A4 is area of this triangle, A3 is this rectangle. So, now the total area equal to A1 plus A2 plus A3 plus A4. So, when you are able to calculate the P1 and P2, P3, then you have to find out this, then you should be able to calculate the total area. Total area, you will get the total wave force. So, now this P1, P2, P3, these are the functions of wave height, wave force, wave period and water depth. In today's lecture, we have understood the basic components of the pressure diagram of the Godas wave force formula. So, I have explained well about how to calculate the wave forces. Now, in our next class, we will discuss about the further calculation through an example. Thank you.